Yeah, so I hope you can see the recording on now, Kaushal.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, yeah, so students, I think that, okay, so some of you have asked, should we join the group, smaller groups during the labs? There won't be any smaller group meetings because the TAs won't be available. They will be busy with the correction of the quizzes. So they won't be available for the smaller group these things. You can write to them, they will respond to you later. So there won't be any meeting in the afternoon. We'll be releasing the lab problems on the on email, and you should be working on them independently. Okay, so let's get started with the our class. We were looking at recursion in the last class, and as you have seen some examples, you know that for a recursive formulation of a problem, we know how to solve the simplest case. Again, the simplest case depends on what problem we are trying to solve. And then when the function is invoked with the complex case, it is dividing it into two parts. The part that the function knows how to do, the part that it does not know how to do. For the part it does not know how to do, it is going to invoke the recursive function, which is the same function again. And this has to be done in a clever way. Okay. So, any questions or comments for this part? Okay, so I think you're still asking about the lab. As I said, we'll be sending out the lab at I think around before 2 o'clock or something, we'll be sending it out. So you can start it at your pace. So let's take questions about the lab at the end of the class if you have any. Okay, so let's try this thing which we left in the last class on Tuesday, that is the length of the string recursively, and I hope at least some of you tried out this length of the string recursively. As I said, you should think about what are the parameters for this function. We are just going to send the address of the string, which we know that the name of the array itself is the address of that address of the first location of the array. So let's say that there is a recursive length which is the function that you're calling, and to it you have sent a character array. The base case is that if the 0th element of that character array is equal to 0, then return 0. This is what we had seen, and we are also crucially assuming that it is a character string which is terminated by a /0. Else, we are going to add 1 to the length of the string starting at str plus 1. So this is the idea. Once you have this idea, you need to put this into a correct piece of code. And I hope some of you did it. Here is a piece of code which captures this correctly. So this rec length is the recursive length function that I have written. It returns an integer. It takes as an input a character array. Again, the length of the character array is unspecified, precisely because this is the function which is calculating the length of the array. We do not know the length of the array, so we cannot say what is the length. And it can take in character arrays of arbitrary length. That is also what we have agreed. So if str is equal to 0, we return 0. Else, we return 1 plus rec length, which is the recursive length function of the string starting at str plus 1. Now, why is this str plus 1 a valid thing to do? Anybody?
Will it do an implicit conversion?
Implicit conversion of what?
The character, not the character.
STR, okay, the address, no, str has the address of the string, right? Rather than the string itself. So then we're just adding one.
Yes, so str denotes the address of the first character in that string. So what is str plus 1 denoting?
Ma'am, because
it is the character. Yeah, please one by one. So Ashwin Beckham.
Because it is character type, address is size is 1, so we are going to next character.
Going to the next character in that string, right? So this str plus 1 is, it is a pointer. It is in fact the location of the next element in that array. And the next element in that array could as well be either either slash zero or a valid character, in which case you will just find the length of the string starting at the next character up to the slash zero. And since you have eaten up or consumed one character, which is at str zero, which was not slash zero, you are adding one to it, right? So the things that you need to note is what this use of str plus one, which is the first time we are seeing this str plus one. The second thing is that str plus one, why is it a valid access? We don't know the length of the string, still we are accessing str plus one. This is something that is valid because we know that str of zero is not equal to zero, and we know that it is a null terminated string. So at some point we must be seeing a slash zero. Therefore, as long as we have not seen a slash zero, it is okay to go further and further down into the string and keep doing str plus one. Note that for the next time you invoke, it is going to do str plus one of that thing, which means actually into the string you have gone str plus two, str plus three, and so on. So this is what you are doing by recursively calling it. And the one that returns the first is going to be when you see the slash zero, that is going to be the first time your thing returns. Then it will be for the penultimate value, which will be, penultimate thing, which will be evaluating to one and two and so on. And this is how you are building the length of the string. So any question? Yes.
Ma'am, while doing str plus one, it will take us to the next character present in the string number. Like, initially, yes. If we are str 0, then it will take us to str of 1, right? But yes. When once we go into the loop again, ma'am, we'll check if str of 0 is double equal to 0. So, but we're not checking str of 1 is double equal to 0, ma'am.
Okay. So, let me just try to annotate it with my poor annotation skills. But let me do it here. Okay. So, this is the array. I hope you can see it. Okay, so let's say that these are valid characters and there is a slash zero here, right? So these are all blanks, are all valid characters, so I'm not writing them. So the first time you have called it with this address str, and it is asking if str of zero is equal to zero, which is not zero. There is some, let's say this string is A. So I did not want to do this. Okay, this is A, this is A, this is A, and this is A. So these are not zeros. So these are all A's. So it is asking whether this is equal to zero. It is not zero. In which case it is moving, it is calling the function with not this, but it is calling it with this address. Okay, sorry. I think it has just gone a little ahead. Okay, so please excuse me, but it has called it with this address that. Okay, I'm so sorry. So let me just draw it again. The first time it was invoked with this address, the second time it is invoked with this address, that is str plus one, and it doesn't know what it is. So let's say that just like you have done calculation in the in your exam. So let's say this was address 1000. This address is 1001. And then you have just passed this address 1001. So at 1001, you are asking what is str of 0. So str of 0, it does mean that it is just going to access 1001 location, which is this, and ask is it slash 0. So just because you have passed str of 1 to the next call, therefore it is implicitly actually accessing str of 1 for the original string that we have. Is that clear, Kandikeshwar, who asked this question?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, any other questions? And this slash 01 is going to be the one which is going to return first. This is going to return a value to us which is 0. that will be returned to the call, which was for this string, which is going to return that its length is 1, which is valid. Then it is going to return to the length 2 string and so on. So sorry, that annotation is gone, but that is how we are going to build the length of the string. Okay. Any other comments or questions? Okay, good. So let's move to the next problem that we want to solve. Okay, so the next problem that we want to solve is again on strings, which is checking whether it is a palindrome or not. And as usual, to design a recursive function, once you have decided that you are going to write a recursive function for something, you will also need to appropriately adjust the parameters of the function that you are going to write. So just because we are beginning this exercise, I have written down the parameters for you. So assume that the inputs to the function, let's say it is called palindrome, are str, which is the string that you are given. There is a start index, which we are calling as start, which is an integer. There is an end index, which is called end, which is also an integer. So these are the two endpoints of the string that you are interested in checking whether it is a palindrome or not. And it is the duty of the, or it is the responsibility of the caller to make sure that the start and end are correct. To begin with, there is a valid string which you want to check as palindrome. So before you write this palindrome, please tell me if there is a character array of size. So there is some character array, let's say A, B, C, D, E, which has 5 characters. What are going to be the start and end that you are going to send from main? So the character array is called, let's say, str. So that is what you are going to send. And what are the indices start and end that you are going to send into the to this function? Yeah, please do not write the function first. Please answer this question. What are you going to call main with? Okay, I see some people answering. Good. Yeah, so Ullas, are you trying to speak something or ask some question? I am unable to hear you. Kaushal, are you able to hear him? Okay, so it seems to be a connection issue. Okay, so some of you are writing the indices that you will send for such a function. Okay, do not write end is equal to length. I do not know what is the length of the string. Have you calculated that? So I have taken an example A, B, C, D, E. This is what we want to check as palindrome. Please answer this for explicitly this question. Okay, so yeah, some of you have said that you will say str of 0 as start and str of 4 as end. That is not correct. These are indices into the array. So you should give, in fact, 0 and 4. Again, not 0 and 5, because 5 will be slash 0. So that should not be something that you should be checking with. So that is something that should be avoided. That is why I explicitly asked you that the string is A, B, C, D, E. Then the last character resides at index 4. Therefore, you should be calling it with 0 and 4 from main. So assuming that you have called it with 0 and 4 and the function is palindrome PAL, which is what you want to write, which takes 3 parameters, one a character array, another two parameters are two integers, which are start and end. Now try to write down how will you write down the palindrome with the base cases and the recursive step.
Ma'am, so we don't know the length of the string, ma'am, initially, or do we know the length of the string?
That is what I'm saying, right? Is the length of the string required? It is going to call from main. So let me again try to annotate. Okay, so this is the array in main, which has a slash 0 at the end, but you have passed whether this to this is a palindrome, right? So this is what you have asked. Do you need the length of the string even when you have passed this? That is the question that we should ask.
I didn't get your one. Let me see the last one, last thing which you said.
So we have passed to this function palindrome this address of the start address here is the name of the string as well as the start index and the end index, right, into the array. Is it still required to for you to know the length of the array?
Like if we know the start and end index, then it's fine, ma'am. But for finding the end index, we need. Okay, I'll see, ma'am. I'll see you.
No, we are going to write this function in this way. Just, I mean, again, this is not the only way you can write a recursive palindrome, just to make the answers uniform. Okay, so one of the questions is, should the function return a zero in case of non-palindromes? Yes, you can return a zero in case of, you can return a zero in case of non-palindromes, one in case of a palindrome. That is a fair enough answer. Yeah. Okay, so I see that you are thinking of writing a function or any non-zero answer for a palindrome. It's okay, you can return one, right? Let's return one when it is a palindrome, then return a zero when it is a not a palindrome. Okay, so I'm looking at your answers. And I request other people also to participate. Most of the common people who are participating, which is good. Okay, so I see that some of you have already written the correct answers. Others, I think, are still trying to write the answer. So let me help people who are still working on it. So one of the ways to think about it is this way. If the length of the string is 1, so Kandikeshwar had asked, is the length of the string required? I had said it is not required. How do you know that the length of the string using these parameters, if start is equal to end, that is the string that we are interested in checking is 1, then it is always a palindrome. One length things are always a palindrome. So if it is start is equal to end, then you can just return that it is 1, that it is a palindrome. Else, if the string length is 2, so how do you know that it is equal to 2? That is start is equal to end is equal to start plus 1, in which case it is equal to 2. Then if start is equal to end again, then it is a palindrome. Are these cases required? We can simplify these things, but I'm just trying to build up the way you can think about it. And then if we are not falling into both of these cases, which are our base cases, then we have this complex case that we want to consider. In which case we ask if start and end are equal. If these two are equal, we are happy. That is, it can be a palindrome, but still we require to check the string between start plus 1 and end minus 1. Again, this can be something which is a single character, or we could have swapped over, in which case that is we just have a two length string, in which case you should have either looked at it earlier or take care of it in the recursive step. So all of you understand what this means. So given these three things, you should be able to put down a piece of code which captures all of these things, right? So you can either check that the length of the string is 1 by checking start and end. You can check the length of the string is equal to 2 by again checking start and end. And if you do not fall into these two cases, then you can convert the, or you can invoke the recursive step, which can be written in the following way. So again, I said that these are not explicitly to be written. You can simplify these things when you write code. I'm not going to give you this code. This is something that you can try out in the lab today. Okay, any questions here? Okay, so I see that many of you have answered it in the chat, which is good, and most of your codes look okay. I have not reviewed the ones that that came in later, but the earlier ones look fine. Okay, so let's do something, one more example, which is small, and then we will move to slightly more advanced examples on arrays, right? Okay, so this is something that we want to do, that is, you have done many times in the course in the lab, as well as several times you are required to pull out digits of a integer. Let's take non-negative integers. And here we are just interested in counting the number of digits. We have already done this multiple times writing a loop, so there is nothing new about this, except that we want to exercise this recursive thinking. That is why we are explicitly writing this recursively. So take a minute to think about it. How will you write this code? Counting the number of digits of a non-negative integer. And please parse this complete statement correctly. You are interested in counting the number of digits of a non-negative integer. If it is an integer 8, then you should give out 1. If it is an integer 800, you should give out 3, and so on. Yeah, so can we start with the base cases? Can people write down what is the base case? So if something happens, then return something. This is the base case, right? What is the simplest thing that the function knows what to do? Please write down the base cases and write them down in the chat. Okay. If n is equal to 0, okay. Okay, no, we cannot take the number as a string and then simply find the length of the string. No, I mean, you have to first convert the number into the string, right? That itself is something. So you have taken an integer n, and you have taken this integer as an integer int data type, and you want to do that, right? Okay.
Ma'am?
Yes?
I was wondering, like, if the base case n is double equal to 0, then shouldn't we consider that 0 to be a...
Yeah, so I leave it to you, right? I leave it to you, yeah.
I don't understand. I'm more like, what do you mean?
No, I leave it to you. So I have said that you should count the digits of a non-negative integer correctly. So if you give 0, what should be the number of digits?
Okay, it should be 1, right? Like non-negative.
Okay, yeah, so the answer should be 1. So I leave it to you to decide how to come up with the base case. I'm not saying that the answer is left to you. The answer should be 1, right? That is clear. Okay. Okay, good. So I see answers already. So the complex case is easy in this case, actually. I mean, okay, so Suchitra, right? I think your complex case has a small issue. It is, please review your complex case. Yeah, Shashank, please check if your base case is okay. Okay, so I'm going to give this template. So the template that I have written is the following. If n is equal to 0, you want to return something. Else return 1 plus number of digits in n diff 10, right? So that is clear. Writing it as number of digits in 1 plus n diff 10 is not correct. That is incorrect. It is 1 plus number of digits in n diff 10. That is something which you can make a mistake. Number of digits of 1 plus n diff 10 is not correct. but I think that is a minor typo that some of you have written. So I will discount that. But I would like you to tell me if I write this, is this okay? If n is equal to 0, can I write something?
Number,
can I return something which will capture what we want?
But if the number ends in 0, then there could be a problem, right? Because if
really?
You put 0 for okay. this.
What is the problem?
Like, suppose we
okay,
have...
First of all, yeah. So, can you please tell me your name?
Chinmay, ma'am.
Chinmay, okay. So Chinmay, first let's see if you have completed this in this way. So if n is equal to 0, return something. Do you have an answer for this? Is it 0, 1, what is it?
No, ma'am. I did if n is a single digit number, then return 1. Otherwise, return 1 plus n by 10, count of n by 10.
Okay, so you have written another thing, right? You have written
yes,
some other base case.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I'll come to that, and that is something which is required. I just want to point out the difficulties with this. But the difficulty, at least according to me, is not when the number ends with 0. In fact, when it does not end with 0, it is something which is a difficulty. So let us say that if n is equal to 0, return 0, then the answer is incorrect for 0. Because for 0, we want that it should be 1. Right, so you cannot write when n is equal to 0, return 0. That will give an incorrect answer for n is equal to 0 itself. If you write n is equal to 0, return 1, then the answer is incorrect for something which does not end in 0. Because for 1, 2, 3, it will count the digits for 1, 2, 3. Then it will make n equal to 0 and call it, and at that time it will return a 1. And therefore, the number of digits in 1, 2, 3 will in fact be 4 and not 3, which is incorrect. So is this clear that this base case cannot capture both the things that we want? That is, it is for 0, it should return 1, as well as for an integer like 1, 2, 3, it should return 3, which is the correct answer for both of them. Right? So the base case has to be changed. And one of the ways to change the base case is that if endif 10 is equal to 0, then return 1, else return 1 plus number of digits in endif 10, right? So again, this is not the only way to change the base case. There are other ways to change the base cases, but this way will correct both of these things. So when n is equal to 0, in fact, endif 10 is equal to 0, therefore it will return a 1. And and also the case that it is not returning an extra 1 for 1, 2, 3. So you can check this out. So the first thing that it will return is for 3, which will be, for 1, which will be 1, then it will be for 12, which will be 2, and for 3, 1, 2, 3, which will be for 3. So that is what it is computing. And I hope you can see that this change will correct the function. Any questions here?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Suppose we have a number 307, 307. Mm-hmm. Then on the second function call, it will become 30. It will pass 30, isn't it?
Okay.
Then n by 10 becomes 0, 30 by 10.
Wait, n by 10 doesn't become 0, right, for 30 by 10? What is 30 by 10?
Yes, ma'am, I was thinking percentage. Okay.
Yeah, it is not mod, it is div. Okay, yeah, Gitartha. Any other question or query on this?
Ma'am, I had a doubt, ma'am.
Yes.
N by 10 would, suppose we took n by 100 and returned 2 plus digits of n by 100 and changed our base case to like n by 100 equals 0, like equal 0, return 2. Like you take the if else cases properly. If you do n by 100, is there a chance for the code to run a little faster, ma'am? Like because.
Code to run faster.
Because larger numbers would be reduced a little faster than n by 10 now. So
number of calls will be fewer, that's what you're saying.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, but you will have to look at several base cases also, right?
Like there'll be just another one, like from 1 to 10 return 1, from 10 to 100 return 2.
Right. Yeah. So you can change that, and you'll have to work out the base cases appropriately. It will be a little faster, but yeah, it can be written out.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah. Good thought. I mean, yeah. Okay. Any other question or comment here? Okay. So let's move on. And so as you see, right, the purpose is not more of writing code. I mean, of course, you will write code eventually in the lab, and you will write recursive functions for several things. But what we are exercising in the class today is more of recursive thinking, and we are going to do a little more of that in for arrays, which will also be very interesting for things that we have seen. For things that which seem quite trivial or quite simple, but writing recursive code makes it a little challenging or a little more non-trivial and therefore interesting for us, right? So we are going to exercise this a little more on arrays, the recursive thinking, and I strongly encourage you to write down this recursive piece of code on a piece of paper before you type out your code, either in today's lab or tomorrow's lab, to make sure that you have taken care of the base cases, hand code it and work it out before you actually start typing it on REPL.IT, right? Okay. So, okay, good. So let's get to something that we have done earlier, which was like computing the largest element of the array, right? So we have already seen this. We have done this when we did selection sort, so nothing new about it, just like the counting of the digits in an integer that we have done. Similarly, finding the largest element in an array is something that we have done multiple times. We have done the second largest and so on. So this is not difficult. So let's think about it recursively, but let's first review what is iterative way of thinking about it. So we go over the array, we keep the largest element, keep comparing with the next element, and do this for all the elements. And when we find that there is something which is larger than the current estimate of the largest, we modify our largest. So it depends on whether we want to return the largest index or the largest the index of the largest element or the largest element itself. Here we are interested in the largest element, not the index of the largest element. Okay, so this is our iterative thinking that we know how to do. Let's go to one way of recursive thinking. So one way of recursive thinking is take out the first element. It can be an arbitrary element. You are given an array, you are taking out the first element, and then find the recursively the largest element in the array which is containing only n minus 1 elements. So this element, call it L. Remember, L is not the index into the array for the largest element from 2 to n minus 1, but it is the largest element itself, right? So this is L. Now, what is the largest element? The largest element can only be one of the first element or this L that you have found out. Therefore, you simply compare between the first element and L and return the largest element in the array. So this is one way of recursively thinking about it, right? Is there any other way of thinking about it recursively? First of all, let's see, is this clear to everybody? Or there are any questions?
Can you explain this?
Yeah, we are going to write code. I am not saying that this is all, but okay, I'll repeat it again. So let's say we are given an array from array of 10 elements from 1 to 9. Let's say we are interested in computing the maximum element of this array, just like we have done in selection sort. Note that we are not interested in the index of the maximum element, the maximum element itself. So how do we do it iteratively? We just think that the first element is maximum and then scan over the array. Instead, what I'm saying is there is a function which gives you the largest element, which takes appropriate parameters, the array, the start index, the end index, and so on, but gives you the largest element in the array, which is from start to end. Then how will you use this, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just store or ignore the first element in the array, and then say that if somebody gives me the largest element from 2 to n minus 1, then the only thing that I need to do is compare the first element and the largest in the 2 to n minus 1. The larger amongst the two is the largest in the array. This is my recursive thinking. I have not said that I have written down code for this. It is my recursive thinking. Is this clear? So Rahul, you had asked the question, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Anybody else has any question or doubt? Okay. Is there any other way you can think about it recursively? Anybody?
Ma'am, can we like create a static variable and change this value with the maximum value that we get?
It's not about static variables and all. Don't worry about static variables.
Okay.
I don't know the thought process for using the static variable. I have not myself thought about it. There may be a way, but it has nothing to do with static variables.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So Upendra has said something that if there is only one element, it is the max. So you compare it with the next element and judge. No, this is iterative thinking, that you keep thinking about, okay, going over the array. So you have, for recursion, you have to think about some smaller problem. So the smaller problem that we have thought about in this case is 2 to n minus 1, or ignore the first element and then 2 to n. This will eventually lead you to an array which is at the last element for which the maximum will be that element. Then you will ask for the array which is of size 2, which is the n minus 2 and n minus 1 and so on. You are going to compute it in this way. But this is one thing that this is the recursive way where we have broken it down into 1 and n minus 1. Is there a different way of thinking about it? Anybody? Okay. So another way of thinking about it is to divide the array into two parts. Again, two is some not necessarily into two parts. You can divide it into any number of parts, but just for the sake of illustration, divide it into two parts. Let's say somebody gives us the maximum of star to mid minus one and mid to end, right? Let's say star and end are the indices of interest for us to find the maximum. Let's say somebody gives us the maximum between start to mid minus one and mid to end, right? Then what will you do? Let's say L1 is the maximum of the first half of the array, L2 is the maximum of the second half of the array. What is the maximum of the array? It's not difficult now, right? Yeah, so we just compare the two. The max has to be between these two because it has to be the maximum of L1 and L2. So this is another way of thinking about it, that is recursively find the largest element in the first half and the second half. How do you find it in the first half? That itself you will do it recursively by breaking it down. This recursion is again going to be on the same way, that is take the first half, break it down into half, and then find the L11 and L12 into that part. Amongst L11 and L12, you will find the maximum and so on. And that will be the maximum of the first half, and the second half will be L2. Finally, compare L1 and L2, right? So these are two different ways of recursively thinking about it. In case of finding the largest element, these do not have a significant, these will not have a difference in terms of the number of comparisons that you do or in terms of the running time as well, but we will see that there are different ways of recursive thinking which will lead to better algorithms when you go to some other problem. So we'll come to that in a minute, but at the moment these are two different ways of recursively formulating them, and we'll show codes for both of them. Okay, so are there any questions about the two things, or so that in the two ways of thinking, the invocations are going to be completely different? Okay, so yeah, so as I said, we'll give the codes for both of them. And so this is the function largest, which takes two parameters, that is I and N. And so the index I is the starting position of the array from where you want to find, and N is the last position. In this case, the array is not parsed. So if the array is not parsed, it has to be a global array, which is visible to the function largest. So you can modify this by passing the array itself. So you can think of start and end as being I and N. They could have been renamed better, but apologies for that. But at the start and end are just I and N are just start and end that we have been calling. So if I is equal to N, then we are going to say that return A of I, which is that the array contains only one element. And we are always going to ensure that I is less than or equal to N. So we don't have to worry. The function doesn't have to worry about I being greater than N. That is what we will ensure by our calls. Else, we have this integer L, which is the largest of I plus 1 to N. And this is what is the recursive call that is being made. This is breaking the subproblem into a N minus 1 size subproblem, and something which you will do at the end. Finally, when you get L, if array of I is greater than L, then return array of I, else return L, right? So that is the simple comparison that you are doing between the largest element from I plus 1 to N and the array element I itself. So again, I as I said, the variable names could have been better. They could have been start and end, and the array can also be passed to the function. But in this case, when it is not passed, you can assume that it is a global variable which is available for the function largest. And again, that is not the point of this example. It is about the two different ways of recursively writing it. Okay. So the second way, which we said, is divide the array into two parts, the first half and the second half. This also can be written as a recursive function, and following is the code where you are again taking two indices into the array I and j. See this, that I and j are no longer now given even n, because in this case n was indicative that it is going to be the end index into the array, which is never changing. Here I and j are going to change because the start and end are going to be different in different calls. Initially they will be 0 and n minus 1. So if I is equal to j, that is you have an one length array, then you of course return whatever is in that array index. So that is array of I or array of j. Else you find largest into start plus end by 2, which we are calling as mid. That is between I and this mid, and then mid plus 1 to the end element, you find this other largest. So you have divided the array into two parts, which is the left part, which is I to mid, which is I plus j by 2, and mid plus 1 to j, which is the second half or the right side of the array. And these are L1 and L2, which are the largest elements. Finally, should I be returning A of L1 and A of L2, or should I be returning L1 and L2?
L1 and L2.
Okay. Remember that we are not returning indices into the array. These are the largest elements themselves. So we are just comparing whether L1 is greater than L2. If L1 is greater than L2, we return L1. Else we have L1 is less than or equal to L2, in which case we will return L2. It can be the case that L1 equal to L2, in which case still returning L2 is fine. So is this... Are these two different codes okay? Okay. So some of you have a question. Yeah, Satyajit. Okay. So sorry, I can't hear you, Satyajit, and you have not typed out anything. So maybe there's no question.
Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yes.
Ma'am, is this program only for numbers from 2 to n minus 1, not for arbitrary array?
For which one, the first one or the second one?
First one, both, ma'am.
Okay, can you say it loudly? I said from 2 to n minus 1. Okay, what from for arbitrary?
The elements, ma'am. Can they contain any arbitrary elements or like continuous from 2 to n minus 1?
Of course, they can contain arbitrary elements. The array values are not at all restricted to be between 1 and n, right? We have never assumed that the array values are restricted. The array values can be anything. They can, in fact, be negative integers also, right? We have never said that the array values are restricted to some ranges. Is that clear?
Okay.
So why do you see that thing that the array values are restricted from? I said we are going to find the maximum in the array index from 2 to n minus 1 or 2 to n, if n, whatever is this n, right? It has nothing to do with the array values being restricted. Is this clear? We are never restricting the array values. Okay, I assume that it is clear, but good. It is a good question that whether we are restricting the array values to have, I mean, be something, right? Okay, so I wanted to do one more example, but I think I will put it in the lab question, which will be an interesting thing to do. So what I want you to do is, we are given an array of integers, arbitrary integers. There is no restriction on the integers. You want to print the array. It's a simple thing. You just want to print the array. You have to write a recursive function to print the array. This is the goal, right? So maybe you can type out your answers. Let's say print A is the function. What parameters will you take? Do not assume a global array. What parameters will you take? And how will you write that function? Is it clear? You don't have the luxury of writing the loop, right? For I is equal to 1 to n, you don't have that luxury because you don't want to write a iterative function. You want to write a recursive function.
Ma'am?
Yes.
So does that mean like we can directly print it from the function, ma'am? Like we can put the printf statement inside the function itself, right?
Yes. Printf is of course used. Printf function call is used. It is. I'm not forbidding you to do that, but you can use. You will have to use the printf in the function. And yes, the array elements can be tab separated or space separated. Doesn't matter. Yeah, you can separate it with a space or a tab. And at the end of it, from the caller, you can print a slash in. That is also okay. So I'm also telling you that from main, you can send the array. You can send other indices that you want. So you should write what is the prototype and then what is the function. It is a small function, but you can write it down. So I wanted to do this on REPL.IT because I wanted to show one more interesting thing, but I'll leave that as a small lab exercise. So I'm not changing my view, because we are almost running out of time. So I'll wait for you to write down the chat messages and tell me how do you write this function to print the elements of an array from left to right in using a recursive function. So it's not a character array. It's not a character array. It's an integer array. So do not use slash zero. Yeah, so one of you who has answered, I think it is Aditya, right? Yeah, it seems to be the correct way to do it. What I just want you to, I mean, this is only a stylistic comment that maybe you don't want to use the function print as the name of the function that you want to write. Just to avoid the confusion with printf, you can write something like print array, print something, just as just to make sure that you don't confuse with the printf statement, right? That is the printf standard library, but otherwise it looks fine. Okay, so I have two answers, but not too many of you have written. So I don't know if people are leaving because it's already time, which is also fine. But I would expect a few more people to write down the answers. Okay, I don't know if Aditya, if you are there, Aditya Ravindran, you had sent some code which I said it is correct, but I think you should check it out whether you are missing something. Yeah, so other people have also written some answers which look okay. So I leave this as a small exercise for you to do in the lab. I will also add to it in the this thing, and there will be a small interesting twist to it which will be good for you to try out in for the lab problem, right? So I repeat, we'll be sending out the lab problems to you. You will have to do it on your own today, and you can of course ask doubts later on if you have any, or you can even email your TAs, but they won't be available as usual, as the way they are for typical practice labs. Also, we'll be meeting tomorrow for our class and then tomorrow afternoon for the graded lab. Okay, so I am going to stop the recording.
Ma'am.